Why? Those wonderful selections. Romans chapter 14. I ask that you would take your copy of God's Word. Turn it with me to Romans chapter 14. If you remember, we started at Romans chapter 1. All the way to Romans chapter 14, which is, if I can subtract correctly, means we have approximately 3 more chapters of the book of Romans to go. Once we finish, guess what I'm going to do? I'm just going to start all over again. No, I ain't going to do that. Romans chapter 14, verses 1 through 12. Those of you who know me, you're saying, that's a lot of verses, more than what he normally reads. It would be an injustice, I believe, to leave out any particular verse in these verses, for they all coincide together to press the point that Paul is trying to press here in this particular passage of Scripture. Romans chapter 14, verses 1 through 12. What about God reads like this? Now, accept the one who is weak in faith, but not for the purpose of passing judgment on his opinion. One person has faith that he may eat all things, but he who is weak eats vegetables only. The one who eats is not to regard with contempt the one who does not eat. The one who does not eat is not to judge the one who eats. For God has accepted both of them. Who are you to judge the servant of another? To his own master he stands or falls, and he will stand. Why? Because the Lord is able to make him stand. One person regards one day above another. Another regards every day alike. Each person must be fully convinced in his own mind. He who observes the day observes it for the Lord, and he who eats does so for the Lord. For he gives thanks to God, and he who eats not for the Lord, he does not eat and gives thanks to God. But not one of us lives for himself, and not one dies for himself. But if we live, we live for the Lord. Or if we die, we die for the Lord. Therefore, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. But to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. But you, why do you judge your brother? Are you again? Why do you regard your brother with contempt? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then, each one of us will give an account of himself to God. I want to preach this morning from the subject, peace in the church. You may keep have your seats. Thank you very much, ushers. You're certainly too kind. Peace in the church. Peace in the church. Once there was a Catholic priest who was walking behind his church. As this Catholic priest was walking behind his church, a thief jumped out of nowhere. When the thief jumped out of nowhere, the thief pressed the muzzle of his gun into the ribs of this Catholic priest. When the thief pressed the muzzle of his gun into the ribs of this Catholic priest, he demanded that the Catholic priest hand over his wallet. Without hesitation, this Catholic priest quickly went into his pockets and gave the thief his wallet. When the thief opened the wallet of this priest, he noticed that the man in the picture had a Catholic collar around his neck. When the thief noticed this Catholic collar around the priest's neck, he asked the priest, "Are you a priest?" And to which the priest answered in the affirmative, "Yes, I am a priest." And without hesitation, the thief quickly closed the wallet of this Catholic priest and handed it back to the priest and informed the priest that "I do not rob priests." Relieved that he would not be getting robbed today, this Catholic priest took his wallet, put it back in his pocket, and pulled out two cigars and attempted to hand one of the cigars to the thief. And to which the thief said, "No, sir, smoking is wrong." The thief and the Catholic priest parted ways because to the thief, robbing somebody was okay, but smoking was wrong. And to the priest, smoking was okay, but robbing was wrong. They parted ways because they had a difference in opinion about something that didn't even matter. In a similar instance, ladies and gentlemen, I have discovered that peace inside of the church is disrupted when one believer overlooks the opinion of another believer. In other words, peace in the church is disrupted when one believer insults the personal beliefs of another believer. Don't misunderstand my statement. I did not say that this peace in the church is disrupted when there are multiple opinions in the church. No. There are always going to be different opinions in the church, but peace in the church is disrupted when one believer thinks that their opinion is greater than someone else's opinion. Therefore, the natural question that arises from the text is, how do you and I have peace in the church? If you and I are going to have peace in the church, it requires first that we respect all different Christian practices. If we are going to have peace in the church, it requires that both you and I respect different kinds of Christian practices. If you graced us with your presence on last week, then you would have heard me preach a sermon entitled "A Life Worthy of Honor." It was inside that little sermon that the question was raised, how do you and I live a life that is worthy of honor? If you took good notes, prayerfully, you learned that if you and I are going to live a life that is worthy of honor, it requires that we show compassion to other people. Not only should we show compassion to other people if we are going to live a life that is worthy of honor, but it also requires that if we are going to live a life that is worthy of honor, it requires that we refrain from sinful situations. And it was based on that argument that Paul transitions into Romans chapter 14, particularly verses 1 through 6, by encouraging each and every one of us to welcome the personal thoughts of other believers. Notice Paul's transitional word, now. Paul's use of the word now is to inform us that I am no longer trying to encourage you to have peace with people in the world. But now I am trying to encourage you to have peace with people in the church. Notice the contrast. Last week, Paul says if you're going to have peace, if you're going to live a life that is worthy of honor, it requires that you show compassion to all people. That includes both people outside the church and it includes people inside the church. But this week, Paul is not talking about peace outside the church. Paul says if you're going to have peace inside the church, now, accept those who are weak in faith. You haven't closed your Bible yet. I plan on preaching from it. Paul says, now this is how you have peace in the church. Accept those who are weak in faith. Paul assumes the position that there are initially or essentially two kinds of people in the church. There are strong Christians and there are weak Christians. And Paul gives the command here, it is up to the strong Christians to accept those who are weak in faith. Word accept there simply means to welcome them in. People who are weak in faith have funny beliefs. Paul says you ought to accept their strange beliefs. Welcome those who are weak in faith. Phrase weak in faith here comes from the Greek phrase asteneopistis. It literally refers to a person who is easily offended. It refers to a person who is easily insulted. It refers to a person who is easily troubled by what you are doing. Paul says, you have come across a weak Christian when they are easily offended. You have come across a weak Christian when they are easily insulted. That is, when you tell them something, they get offended by what you told them. Paul says, that is a characteristic of a person who is weak in the faith. Paul says, but don't push them away. He says, welcome them in. How do you welcome a Christian who is weak in the faith? Paul answers, don't welcome them in for the purpose of passing judgment against their strange beliefs. Don't welcome them. men for the purpose of passing judgment against their weird beliefs? Paul says when you come in contact with a weak Christian who thinks or doesn't fully understand the Christian liberty, Paul says, don't be so quick to tell them you ought not do that. Because what will happen is you will insult them. You will offend them. And instead of helping them, they will walk away from God. And Jesus says, woe unto the one who offends one of my little ones. You're walking on dangerous territory when you insult a child of God. Paul says, but not for the purpose of passing judgment on his opinions. Why should we make sure that we are not insulting a weak Christian? Verses 3 and 4 explain to us why it is that we are to make sure we do not insult weak Christians. Paul says, the one who eats is not to regard with contempt the one who does not eat. The one who does not eat is not to judge the one who eats, for God has accepted both of them. Paul illustrates why we should not insult or offend a weak Christian by using food. Don't miss Paul's point here. Paul is not trying to make the point about eating meat or whether you should not eat meat. He's not trying to make the point whether or not a Christian should only eat vegetables or it's all right for a Christian to eat meat. Paul uses this simply as an illustration to prove his overall point that there are many different beliefs inside of the church. But if you think that eating meat is wrong, then don't eat it. And if you think that eating meat is right, then go ahead and eat it. But you who think that it's wrong, don't judge the person who thinks it's right. Verse 4 says, because who are you to judge someone else's servant? This is interesting because in churches today, we don't have a problem with different foods. We ain't got that problem. We got problems with the way you shout. We got problems with the way you clap. If clapping offbeat is the way you praise God, then go ahead and clap offbeat. If your sway is different from everybody else's sway, if your sway is how you praise God, then go ahead and sway your way. Paul says, who are you to judge the way someone else decides to honor their God? There are different ways that we choose to honor God. You may pray on your knees. I may pray standing up. You may do this one way. I may do it this way. I may read the NASB. You may read the King James Version. But who are you to talk about how someone else decides to serve their God? Paul's point here is that we don't owe each other an explanation about how we praise God. But let me praise God the way I praise Him, and you praise God the way you praise Him. And when that goes together, we can have a hallelujah good time. But when you're worrying about how I'm praising God and I'm worrying about how you praising God, there is disruption of peace inside the church. Paul says, who are you to judge someone else's servant. To his own master, he stands or falls. And he will stand because God is able to make him stand. And he will stand because God is able to make him stand. Interestingly, we are all servants of God, aren't we? Biblically speaking, there were different ranks of servants to those who were not servants. The lowest of lowest you could be in the biblical days was a foot washer. So, if I was visiting your house, person at the door who washed feet, I would say they are the lowest of lowest servants. I would say that because I would not be a servant. But to the servants, they didn't see ranks among themselves because they understood that it doesn't matter what capacity you serve. The fact of the matter is, we are all servants. So in a slave's mentality, in a servant's mentality, the cupbearer wouldn't look down on the foot washer. Because they understood that you may wash feet for the master, and I may bring the master water, but we all serve the same master. Hear me, your praise may be unorthodox, your worship may be disruptive, the way you shout might get on somebody else's nerve, the way you pray might bother somebody else, but who are we to talk about how you decide to worship your God? Going to have peace in the church, we must respect different Christian practices. Primarily because we all are worshiping the same God. We worship him differently, but ultimately we are worshiping the same God. I never understood for the life of me why different denominations do not fellowship. Why Pentecostals don't fellowship with Baptists, why Church of Christ don't fellowship with Catholic. It's because we have different preferences. The Church of Christ, they don't believe that you should have music, musical instruments in the church. They believe that you should use the natural tone of your voice to sing praises to God. And I ain't got no problem with that. You want to use your natural tone of voice, if you want to sing a cappella to praise your God, then go ahead and sing a cappella. I like a little a cappella every once in a while, but you shouldn't have no problem with me playing my music if we are serving the same God. You go Catholic church and they want to sip from the same cup, I ain't got no problem with that. But I don't want to sip from the same cup. I want my own cup. But I ain't got no problem with you sipping from the same cup. They have a different way of worshiping their God, but ultimately we are worshiping the same God. Paul says, who are you to judge the servant of another? You are servants of God. I am a servant of God. But the way we serve him is different. But if you're going to have peace in the church, I have to respect the way you serve. You have to respect the way I serve. belong to God. Thought I'd have a witness then. Glad I brought my own. Psalm chapter 24, verse 1, David says, "The earth is the Lord's, the fullness thereof, and they that dwell therein." Translation, everybody who is in the world belongs to God. More specifically, every Christian in the church belongs to God. And because we belong to God, in verses 5 and 6, Paul exhorts us, Paul encourages us to honor God according to what we understand. When Paul was writing to the Roman church, these were people who came out of paganism. They came from different beliefs, and they came into the church and they believed with everything that was in them that Jesus Christ died, rose for the sins of the world. They believed that. But because of where they were spiritually, there were some things that they thought were wrong that were not necessarily wrong. And there were other things that they thought were right that were not necessarily right. But Paul says because of where they were spiritually was why they thought the way they thought. When the church understands why a person thinks what they think, it should be better able to meet them where they are. But the reason peace gets disrupted in the church is when the strong Christian sees a weak Christian doing something that the strong Christian ain't got no problem with. Instead of meeting them where they are, we go to them and tell them, "You shouldn't be doing that. You shouldn't be saying that. You shouldn't be talking like that." But Paul tells us right here in the text that the church is made up of two kinds of Christians. Weak Christians and strong Christians. The weak Christians say, "Them strong Christians ought not be eating at me." And the strong Christians say, "Them weak Christians, they don't know nothing about this meat." You see the disruption there? But when the strong Christian says, "They just don't know no better. You know, ain't nothing wrong with this meat. So we just ain't gonna eat the meat in front of them if it offends them." If the weak Christian would say, "I think there's something wrong with eating the meat, but if they don't think there's nothing wrong with eating the meat, then that ain't got nothing to do with it." But when there is disruption between two parties, there can be no peace. Paul exhorts us to honor God according to our understanding. What does that mean? That means that if you think something is wrong, then don't do it. And that way, you honor God according to your understanding. And if I think something is wrong, then don't do it. And that way, I honor God according to my understanding. And when we both honor God according to what we understand, we can have peace inside of the church. Who are you to judge another man's master, another man's servant? God is able to make us stand. If you are a Christian, it is God's responsibility to keep you. The text says that God has the ability to keep you. When you go against your conscience is what eats at you, when you go against your conscience, that's when you sin. When your conscience tells you that what you're doing is wrong, but you do it anyway. The Bible says to him, it is sin. If you're going to have peace in the church, it requires that you respect all kinds of different Christian practices. There are different ways to serve God. There are different ways to honor God. Your way may not be my way. My way may not be your way. But when you respect my way of worship and I accept your way of worship, there will be peace in the church. But when you got a problem with the way I lift my hands in the sanctuary and I got a problem the way you sit there with your arms folded, then we got a problem in the church. But when I respect your way of worship and you respect my way of worship, we can have peace in the church. I'm moving on. Not only must you respect all different kinds of Christian practices, but if you are going to, if there's going to be peace in the church, it requires that we remember who Christians belong to. Requires that we remember who Christians belong to. In verses 7, 8, and 9, Paul reminds us that Jesus Christ has authority over heaven and earth. Translation, everything on earth belongs to Christ, and everything in heaven belongs to Christ. We belong to Christ. Paul says, for not one of us lives for himself, and not one dies for himself. For we, if we live, we live for the Lord, or if we die, we die for the Lord. Therefore, whether we live or whether we die, we belong to the Lord. The word live here comes from the Greek word zao. It refers to physical life. I explain that because zao could mean spiritual life, it can mean physical life, it can mean animal life, it can mean several different kinds of life. Here in the context of the passage, life refers to physical life. Paul says, those who are physically alive in Christ belong to the Lord, and those who are physically dead in Christ belong to the Lord. We belong to the Lord. What does that mean? That means that since we belong to God, it is up to us to serve God how we see fit to serve God. Paul says, for if we live for the Lord, or if we die for the Lord. Whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. Paul explains in verse number 9 that Jesus Christ has authority over everything, whether it is dead or alive. Jesus declares his authority. Matthew chapter 28, somewhere around verses 16 through 20, Jesus declares that all power has been given unto me in heaven and on earth. And he commands his disciples to go into all the world and preach and teach and baptize everything that I have commanded you. Jesus has authority over all things, all people, whether dead or alive. Because Jesus has authority over all people, all things, whether dead or alive, we should remember who Christians belong to. When we remember who Christians belong to, it would keep us from being so judgmental about how they choose to serve God. You see somebody shouting, you don't agree with the way they are shouting, guess what? They ain't shouting for you. You see somebody singing and you don't like the way they holding the mic, guess what? They ain't singing for you. You see or hear somebody preaching and they preaching too long, guess what? He ain't preaching for you. Paul says, if we remember who Christians belong to, it will help us not be so judgmental. He uses the illustration here of eating meat. He also uses the illustration here of both different days. Paul is writing to both Jews and Gentiles. The Jews were still holding on to the Sabbath day. They believed that God should be worshiped on Saturday. And the Greeks said, no, we believe that we should serve God or worship God on Sunday, the day that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. Do you see the difference there? There was disruption about days. There was disruption about meat. That's not Paul's point here. He illustrates, he uses these figures to illustrate what could be happening in the church when people have different opinions about different things, but they both belong to the same God. Paul says you ought to be able to work it out. You ought to be able to work out your differences. Let me just tell you this. There's a word called morality. Morality deals specifically with what is right and what is wrong. But there's also a different word called amoral. A-M-O-R-A-L. Amoral means non-moral. It means there's no right way. Oh, there's no wrong way. When you talk about morality, you talk about what God has noted in his word that you shouldn't be doing. When you talk about morality, you talk about what God has noted in his word about what you should be doing. But when you talk about immoral, you talk about, well, if you want to do it that way, that's fine. Or if you want to do it another way, that is fine, because there is no right or wrong way to do it. That is how you keep peace in the church. When the church understands that there are some issues, that there is no right or wrong way, it is all about your preference. Whether you want to have church on a Saturday, that's your business. I ain't got no problem with you having to. When you want to have church on Monday, that's your business. There's no rule that says you have to have Bible study on Wednesday. There's no rule that says you have to have a sunrise service. There's no rule that says church has to start at 11 o'clock. But if you want to do that, that's your business. Paul says if there's going to be peace in the church has to understand the difference between morality and immoral. Yes, there are some things that God says, this is what I want done. But then there are other things that God says, this is what I want done, but I don't care when you do it. must respect other kinds of Christian worship, service, or practices. And if there is going to be peace in the church, you must remember who Christians belong to. Lastly, I'm in my seat. If there is going to be peace in the church, you must remember who Christians report to. There are different ways to worship God. You have to worship God according to your own understanding. All Christians belong to the Lord Jesus Christ, and all Christians will report to Jesus Christ. I need for you to get that. You are not accountable to me for how you serve God. But you are accountable to God for how you chose to serve Him. Okay, I ain't going nowhere to you. That sinks down into your soul. You are not accountable to me or nobody else in here about how you serve God. But there will come a time when you will stand before the judgment seat of God and you will have to give an account to God about how you chose to serve Him. Verses 10, 11, and 12, Paul reminds us that we will all report our personal thoughts to God. That's what the Bible speaks about. Our thoughts will be tried in the fire. Our works will be tried in the fire. This is very important because oftentimes I've been in church all my life. Normally when I go other places to preach, the first thing that I say is I've been black and Baptist all my life. Which means I know church folk. And sometimes church people will worship God in a way, but they're not really worshiping God. They're really worshiping themselves. That is, we woke up this morning with the idea that I'm going to see how big of a fool I can act today. Ain't got nothing to do with God. It's all about how I can perform on today. And it's important for us to keep in mind that one day you're going to stand before God and God's going to say, do you remember on May 31st, 2015 when you acted a plump fool, what you do that for? You're going to say to God, God, I was worshiping you. And God's going to say, no, I'm the God who knows the hearts of men, and what you did, they have nothing to do with me. Paul says you have to remember that you will report to God. Paul says, but you, why do you judge your brother? Or you again, why do you regard your brother with contempt? We will all stand before the judgment seat of God. The judgment seat of God here is simply a place of authority. When Paul uses the phrase judgment seat of God, he is talking about you and I being in the very presence of God. There will come a time, ladies and gentlemen, that we will be in the very presence of God, but it's not to be condemned. A Christian will not be condemned, but a Christian will be rewarded for what they did and what they didn't do. Paul speaks about Christians standing before the judgment seat of God. He's talking about the rewards that you could have had, but you couldn't get. And God giving you what you deserve. Paul said there will come a time when we will all stand before the judgment seat of God and we will give an account of what we did based on what we thought. So you're welcome to serve God in any way you feel the need to serve Him. My only concern for the body of Christ is that you make sure that you serve God in a way that is pleasing in the eyesight of God. Because there will come a time that you will stand before the judgment seat of God and you will have to give an account to God about what you did or what you did not do. Paul validates this point by quoting Isaiah 45, verse 23. He says, there will come a time when every knee shall bow. There will come a time when every tongue will give praise to God. What will be the result of that conversation between you and God? Verse 12, so then each one of us will give an account of himself to God. Not God asking you, Brother Charles, what did you think about Brother Henderson's way of praising me? Deacon Guillory, did you agree with the way Brother Baptiste praised me? Ain't got nothing to do with you. How you choose to serve God is between you and God. If there's going to be peace in the church, ladies and gentlemen, it requires that we respect different ways of worshiping God. It requires that we remember who Christians belong to, and it requires that we ultimately remember who Christians will report to. There was a fourth grade teacher by the name of Mr. Roberts. Mr. Roberts introduced a game called Balloon Stump to two different fourth grade classes. One fourth grade class was a class of normal fourth graders. Mr. Johnson gave them the rules that the goal of the game is to pop everyone else's balloon, and the last person who still has their balloon inflated, that is the person who will win the game. He tied balloons to everyone's ankles, and everything went crazy. Everybody started running around trying to pop one another's balloon, and in a matter of seconds, the game was over, and there was only one person standing saying, my balloon is still intact. Blood was everywhere, heads busted open, fingernails broken, shirts torn, because everybody was trying to pop somebody else's balloon. Mr. Roberts went to another fourth grade class. This fourth grade class was not normal fourth graders. They were mentally challenged. He gave them the same instructions that he gave the normal fourth grade class. Said the object of the game is to pop everybody's balloon, and the last person with their balloon inflated will win the game. He tied balloons to their ankles. Maybe they didn't understand the instructions. Because in a matter of minutes, everybody brought their balloon to the center of the floor. And they all popped their own balloon. And everybody cheered that they were all Do you see the contrast there? Modern day church is more in tune to be the last person standing. To be the person who has the best opinion. My thoughts are the only one who matters, but God is looking for a church of people who can come together with their differences and celebrate together. God bless you, God. The doors of the church are open. If you are here today and you do not know the Lord,